got a gain of about three. More importantly, it's going to be Macalester's first down of the game as we welcome in our regular play-by-play guy, Cormac Seeley. Cormac, welcome to the booth.
Yeah, I get that for one more week here, Josh, of a regular play-by-play guy till you or some other victim gets into it.
Oh, I'm looking forward to it. I mean, we'll miss you, I think, and even our listeners will miss you as well. But looking forward to doing play-by-play,
yeah.
I guess.
Well, you're doing a great job getting warmed up there. I say I had to stop after walking up the stairs. At age, it takes a toll. So Scott's in the shotgun. Petrich takes the ball, hands off, and gets about 3 yards on the play.
Macalester coming out with the run here early on, and it's different than what you and I saw in week one here when they took on Carlton and threw the ball quite a bit, but it's been rapport and Stefan here early. I get Macalester marching down the field.
I noticed coming in, we have a little guest on the field today, the Edina High School Band. Good, so I promise I'll make one cake eater reference early on in the game, and that'll be it for the Edina area. Thinking about, we got a couple fine coaches on the baseball side that did some work with the Edina Legion program and such, so we have fondly say that about them. Petrus takes the snap, looks to the right, throws, complete to Johnny Knee, and he's out of bounds after a good job eluding the first tackle. He gains a couple extra yards.
Scots are moving the ball well here. This drive started at about their own 24 after a kick return, and nothing but positive plays so far. A nice mix that finally brought a passing play in there, so they're trying to mix it up now a little more.
These are very interesting games. I mean, this is certainly, Lake Forest probably more than Monmouth last week, a game that the Scots are a little more probably physically on par with in terms of the talent on the field. But, this is an important one, but you also don't want to give away too much. You know, these game films go out to the other teams, and you just want to tune up what you have and still be competitive. Because it doesn't count in the final standings. You know, the final tally doesn't include this game that gives you your conference standings.
It's certainly, I think that's a bit weird, but that's a good point. I mean, this game and last week's game were Midwest Conference games, but you're right, they don't really count in where Macalester will finish in the Midwest Conference.
No, I mean, I think, with the, Monmouth 37-0 over Monmouth Scots over the Macalester Scots 37-0, I think, I'm hoping that Mac, in the process of that, probably learned a lesson about, if I remember Monmouth, they're quite big on the line, probably. Macalester learned what it's like to be physical in the trenches a little bit and some things, but you also don't want to show all your fun wrinkles that game.
No, certainly. Those two teams could meet right back here in the last week of the regular season.
Catch by Beatty. Nice throw from Petrich. That's going to move the ball ahead 9 or 10 yards. They're saying right away, first down. The chain gang, Josh, you and I both served in that capacity for a while. They did a nice job waiting until somebody said go.
Yeah.
It's always a test of discipline is don't get too excited.
Yeah, got to wait for that official on that side to tell you when it's time to move. Otherwise, you stay put. I think this is the ambience today is different. With the Edina High School marching band here, it's a much more fun environment now with a little band playing. That's college football.
Yeah, I would say because I give it a second here to explain what the normal musical ambiance is here. But Petrus drops back into play action, goes deep down the seam. Beatty catches it and touchdown for the Scots.
What a throw. Wonderful pitch and catch there from Petrus to Beatty. Beatty again gets behind the defense and Petrus hits him. That has been a recipe for a lot of points so far this season. And that's how they cap off their first drive of the game here. That's very exciting. A great way to get this game going.
I mean, we don't spend too much time watching Beatty. I don't necessarily watch Beatty off the ball. You know, we're going to go back and zoom in on him. But so it's hard to talk about how much he did to get separation on the play. But Petrich just dropped a beautiful ball right into his basket.
Yep, just dropped a dime right. And actually, Petrich was under some pressure, too, to be able to have composure and drop that pass in.
So Shosie's kick is blocked. And actually, I was about to say, Andrew Smith did a nice job of even getting the ball corralled into his hands. Looked like kind of a tough snap, and Smith got it to the spot, but timing was a bit off. So Macalester goes up 6-0, and take away from that a very encouraging first drive for Max. Josh, as you said, lots of positive plays, and there was a bit of a rhythm to that, even different from, the Carlton game and some things. Mac felt like they moved a little bit down the field, and probably the way they want to run that offense, pitching the ball around to the boundaries, running opportunistically.
Well, yeah, great balance there. I think if what that drive shows us, what Mac's going to commit to doing today, it's balance. You saw the first three, four plays, kept it on the ground, got big chunk games there, dropped a couple of short passes, and then when the time was right, they hit the big one to Beatty. So Coach Davies is off to calling a great game, and the offensive players are certainly executing that game plan. So now we'll see how Macalester plays on defense. Be a really big shot in the arm if they can get a big defensive stop here, get the ball back into the offense's hands because they were rolling right there.
Yeah, you were talking about the ambiance. It really does lend itself much more to college football to have a band out here. Normally we've got some pretty lonely Hound Dog Country from Ron Osterman's playlist going, you know, before and after the game. It's, you know, tractors, dogs, and somebody left you kind of thing. But it's so much more of a pick-me-up to have the band out here and gives it so much more of that atmosphere you see on TV a bit.
Anyone else?
good first drive there for the Macalester defense. They allowed one first down. I mean, it was on a scramble play, so it was covered well and defended well. Quarterback just was able to scramble for a couple of yards. So great job tackling there on the first drive for the Scots defense.
Scotsville back out on offense. They're going to be pinned at their own 10 right now, but if the last drive is any indication, they did a nice job moving the ball down the field. This just gives them a few more yards to gain on the drive. Petrich. Now Stephanos get behind him. Petrich, Reed, throws the outside. Nice throw again to Beatty. Those two are working out quite a rhythm together.
Dare I say Peyton Manning-esque on that one? He looked at Beatty, and he was about to start his break when Petrich threw that football. If you didn't know Beatty was running that route, you thought, where's that ball going? And then all of a sudden, Beatty's there, makes the catch. Perfect timing right there. You can tell those two have rehearsed that play a lot, and their timing was perfect on that one.
And so now the Scots have a little bit of breathing room, 15-yard completion. Step back up. Seconds on the play clock. Petrich sends Lepore in motion, and he's going to get the handoff. Lepore just got his hand on his lead blocker, and he's going to follow that to a gain of 2 yards. I always love that piece where you get the one or two guys pulling from the offensive line, and the running back has that hand right behind him, just making sure we keep a distance.
And in some cases, the running back can't see over that lineman, so he's got to just put his hand on his back and follow him because he doesn't know where he's going. He's just going to follow the big guy. That's usually pretty good, pretty good policy to have as a running back. Follow the big guys.
Yeah, it's 2nd and 7 coming up. Strybick in motion. The right side, he's going to be in that near slot position. Stephan takes the handoff, goes to the right side, and looks like he's going to gain about 2 or 3 yards.
We'll see what Coach Davies has here for this 3rd and medium. I don't know that you quite call this long, but it's certainly not short.
Yeah, this is a weird distance, right? I mean, this seems like screen central distance right now.
Very well, it could be. But when you have a weapon like Alec Beatty, too, if you run into a nice crisp route and a little shake move, perhaps that's an option. They're going to back up 5.
Yep. I was going to say, so this will clear up the play call a little bit, and it's going to be 3rd and 10.
It's the freshman Josh Wink out of Coronado, California, getting the start today on that right side. Big 6'3", 250 right tackle, just a little too antsy on that pass block.
But it looked like Rapport, if he was the one going in motion possibly, also had the timing a little bit off, so I don't know that everybody was on the same page on that.
Petrich had to signal that motion for the motion. I think it was Strybick.
Okay. Now Strybick goes in motion the other way again. 7 on the play clock. Big drop for Petrich. And ball's on the ground. And picked up by Lake Forest. Oh, a sack from behind. Number 54 on the sack for Lake Forest. It's going to be Jordan McInerney.
Big James Pruitt on the defensive line fell on that, and that's a break for Lake Forest. You know, when you go from that 3rd and 5 to now 3rd and 10, and you got to run deeper routes, you know, obviously you got to protect longer. And the protection wasn't that bad, just as Petrich stepped up to look for some open space, got hit from behind. Coverage was good.
Just starting to look through Lake Forest roster a little bit. It's an incredible slate of freshmen and sophomores. Got a little screen pass to the outside. Some nice blocking by Lake Forest wide receivers, and Macalester able to get the ball carrier down after gain of 5. But Lake Forest, a lot of freshmen and sophomores on the roster. They've really filled in that bottom two classes in a big way, and a very diverse slate across the U.S. Lots of Arizona. Lots of Texas on here. Not something we generally see in Midwest Conference.
No, certainly not. You know, some of the schools, like when we watched Macalester play Carleton, there was a lot of diversity in terms of geography. Those two schools recruit nationally. Maybe Lake Forest does as well. I'm just not familiar with their rosters of the past.
And that may be a little bit of a change for them in terms of philosophy. Adams with the carry for Lake Forest. He's ahead to the 12. That's going to be a first down. So first down with a possibility to get another before a score for Lake Forest. They're working on a very short field after fumble recovery. Josh, I don't know if you talked about a little bit of a breeze today, but quite a stark difference from the last time we were sitting up here sweating it out against against Carleton. It's down in the 50s and a bit much brisker. Quarterback's going to step up, make a run for it. He dives. That'll be a gain of about 5. So we've seen two nice runs by the quarterback for Lake Forest.
Digging to Cleary out of Yuma, Arizona. There's one of those Arizona guys you're talking about.
Lake Forest lines up quickly. Instructions out to the wide receivers. There's looking left and
that's
wide open.
Six.
Yep. I'd say that's very different from that pass into the side, into the boundary that we talked about earlier, Josh, where Scott's got on that quickly. They weren't quite as fast recovering out to that.
That's a good route, good throw. Saw 55, Josh Bartz trying to pursue, but he was just too far away to really make anything happen there. So Lake Forest taking advantage of the turnover, the takeaway.
Lake Forest is going to set up for the extra point. They tied the game 6-6. Callister punched in a touchdown there. First drive and had the extra point blocked. Try to turn that around on Lake Forest. Here's the snap. Hold. Kick is up, and it is good. So Lake Forest take a one-point lead after quick scoring drive on the short field. Macalester will get the ball back for their third possession to have a little more success in terms of holding on to it.
Yeah, today feels much more like when you think of football weather versus that Carleton game. But it's chilly. There's the crisp air. The guys are pumped up. This feels much more like a football Saturday. And again, we got the band here, so again, it feels even more like a college football Saturday.
It is such a different. It's amazing what the band thing adds. Josh, you've kind of picked up adopted a team, if you will, in the SEC.
Well, we had. I don't know that we still are, but but they are the best marching band in all of college football. It's the pride of the Southland marching band, the Tennessee Volunteers. We followed them for a couple of years and actually went to a game. And what an atmosphere down there in Dillon Stadium with 102,000 people.
Yeah, but it's amazing with the band. You know, that's just ubiquitous with watching the game on TV.
Certainly.
Or playing there.
Certainly.
So, Callister will take the kickoff. Johnny Neal will take it and ahead to the 29, and he topples head over heels. Get an extra yard or two on the play. That'll start McAllister's third drive, just short of the 30-yard line. And that is something, I think McAllister over the last 5 years or so, and a credit to the parents who had kids in the program over that time. They made this a day-long thing. And I think that's something when you go to those SEC games, see it tailgating, and it's not a three-hour event in the middle of the day. It's an entire day where a football game kind of intersects it in the middle. And that's the Calster parents have done a good job making it that way. And the attendance?
Well, they've done a fantastic job as brought to Strybeck. But I think you're right. What the parents have done to support these players is nothing short of amazing. Given that, you know, we talked about it earlier, the national profile of Macalester and how so many students aren't local kids. So there's parents that are traveling far and wide to get here to support their sons and their friends. And really cool to see the cookout before, and then they feed them a meal after the game and just are here to support these kids on Saturdays.
Yeah, and I you see a lot of the parents hanging out with each other. There's a large knot of them that seem like they sit together in the middle of the stadium and stuff. It's really, it's a great atmosphere of support. And along with the whole program, I mean, Nice scramble up the middle for Petridge. He's going to try to make dance it a little bit, and he's going to get some extra yards.
Big blocks from Stefan and Beatty on that play. Got him an extra probably 15 yards on both of those blocks.
The Niners fan in me is freaking out as he's going to the sideline. So hoping he made a much better decision than Jimmy did last weekend. But good for Petridge. I mean, a nice little shake and bake move. I mean, that's going to be his highlight reel for the year. It's going to be that little dance in the middle.
I called out Stefan and Beatty for throwing great blocks, but really that shake and bake, the little that little move that Petridge put on really got him the extra 15. Those guys were just there to help.
That's just like, you know, like you were talking about Peyton Manning earlier as a comparison. That's kind of like Peyton. You do it slow enough and it works. Petridge now gets his breath, steps back, timing throw to the outside, goes to Beatty. And I like what Beatty did there. Beatty caught the ball and actually backed up into the game. I mean, he didn't try to square up or do anything too fancy. He just caught it and fell.
He caught it at about a 9-yard gain and said, "Well, I'll just fall into this 10-yard gain."
Yep. And the Scots not a huddling team out there, so they get the instructions in from the sideline. It gets relayed to everybody with the wristband communication, and the team's gonna play off of that. It's rare they all get together and talk about anything out there, but there's still a lot of communication that goes on between the team. Petridge will be in the shotgun. Stefan next to him. Stefan steps up, releases. Petridge looking downfield. And
they threw the beanbag, but I don't think that's a I'm pretty sure Petridge's arm was coming forward, but I saw the referee throw the beanbag when it happened, and when you see that, it means he thought it was a fumble.
So second possession in a row that say it was an empty hand going forward. So second possession in a row, the Lake Forest pressure on Petridge has come around and created a fumble.
Yeah,
one thing that
curious to see a replay there. I don't know that the hand was empty. Of course, we're way up here, and certainly the official has a much better view.
It certainly looked like a lot of momentum going forward, and I think. You know, that kind of leads to what I was going to say, where both fumbles, Petridge actually has a bit of a running lane up front. Lake Forest is really selling out up the field, so we'll see if they make an adjustment on that type of thing. This time the pass wide from Lake Forest goes incomplete to the sideline.
That's a tough break. That's a tough break for the Scots. And you're right, both times he was hit from behind. When you hit from behind holding the ball in kind of a passing motion, it's going to be hard to hold on to that thing when a big defensive lineman's barreling down on you like that.
Yeah, that's going to have to be an adjustment. I don't think we've seen a team in a while, just watching some of the webcasts and some things, has put that kind of upfield pressure on the Scots necessarily. You can see the pocket collapse on them in front.
Right.
But not necessarily around the back.
And you might see, you know, Coach Davies might see that and say, hey, well, let's hit him with a couple of draws and let's see if we can draw those defensive ends upfield and then hand it off to Stefan or rapport and see if they can grab something up the middle. Because like you said, I think both those times there may have been a running lane there. Petridge obviously looking to pass first, which is his strength. So maybe you'll see a draw or two be set up here to invite that upfield pressure and kind of hit him right back up the middle.
It's going to be a big third down coming up, third and six after the run of 4 yards up the middle for Lake Forest. Pistol formation. Lake Forest quarterback drops back, surveys over the middle, throw completed in front of some Macalester defenders, and they finally get the receiver on the ground after about 16-17 yard gain. Nice play for Lake Forest.
Number
pitch and catch.
83, Ted Crane on the catch, the junior out of Phoenix, Arizona.
Yeah, that Arizona connection for Lake Forest going well.
Big pickup there for the Foresters.
Snap and a run up the middle. And this is an interesting one. Macalester,
end of the first quarter.
We're going to have end of the first quarter. Even before Macalester joined the Midwest Conference, this was a game, a non-conference game that's got very early on. So I remember the first year out of school, 2006, Macalester played Lake Forest, went there. And so series of games that Macalester picked up very early on, and now it just sort of has folded into being a Midwest Conference form.
I think it's a good matchup for both teams. I think both it's a natural pairing here, both in terms of, you know, obviously roster sizes and profile and those things.
And I think at the time, you know, when you go back to 2006, you wouldn't wouldn't necessarily say the roster size was that much of a thing. I mean, Macalester was
much smaller.
I was going to say 20 or 30 guys less, probably. And that's, you know, as we talk on that program evolution, we talked about it from an atmosphere perspective, but another big part of it is there's simply more people involved in the program and more people involved in 4 years of the program that they've got going. I mean, they've got a nice balance across their four classes represented on the team. It's not overweighted one side or the other. And
well, yeah, there was teams, you know, 10, 15 years ago at Macalester that certainly had good athletes on the front end, you know, but then the depth just wasn't there. And now here, when you build out a roster this size and you start building out those classes, now all of a sudden you have depth. And as you well know, football is a game where you need a lot of depth. Injuries happen all the time. Things happen in the course of the game. And if the next guy up just isn't, you know, isn't up to par, well, you're not going to be in a lot of football games.
It's and I don't know if this is something that Macalester's picked up on or whether they're intentionally doing this. Run to the left side brings up third and two for Lake Forest, but Lake Forest feels like they were always on the far hash on their offense, and all of a sudden they feel right in front of us because now...
Ooh, big rush.
And I was gonna, now as I say that, they go the opposite way. Get the ball carrier on the ground, but after the first down pickup on a gain of five.
Danku Blake came on a blitz there, or came on pressure there, maybe not a blitz, but he came on some pressure there, put a pretty good lick on Cleary, but Cleary got the ball away just before to that swingman. The flying Hawaiian came flying around the edge there, though. Put a big hit on him.
Fake throw to the outside corner, and Calster finally covers. Andrew Smith got caught in a tough spot. He kind of had two guys
he had to cover.
He took the deep guy, which is good choice, but nice completion, nice play design by Lake Forest.
Boy, they're really taking advantage here of turnovers. You know, the first one was the short field, and here they've hit, you know, a big play there, and they're knocking on the door again.
Nice run up the middle by number 21, Nick Edlund.
He finished that run off pretty well, too. Got his teammates on the sidelines pretty excited.
Look, just short of the first down, it's going to be second and maybe a half yard to go. Lake Forest just shy of the 5 yard line. Going to run Edlund again. Gets back in the middle, this time wrapped up by Macalester. Nice job by the D line of Macalester. Step up, pull down the ball carrier. Basically no yards. It's going to be third and very short again.
It was inside linebacker Paul Brinson wrapped him up and didn't let him get any more inches even. I mean, he pretty much stopped him dead in his tracks, and then, of course, the pursuit catches up there. But really, Brinson was the first guy on the ball. Here we go. Another crucial third down early. I mean, it's hard to call them crucial because it's so early in the game, but they are. I mean, a stop here, you know, perhaps forces a field goal attempt.
They have the 6'1", 250 halfback in the game in front of lead blocker, in front of Alex Adams. Adams runs into a beehive at the 2 yard line, and that's where they're going to whistle the play dead. Number 91, Michael Dean, is a 6'1", 250 sophomore halfback. Quite the lead blocker.
He wears number 91.
91.
I don't know that you see a lot of guys in the backfield with number 91. Reminds you of like. The fridge, William Perry on the 85 Bears. He lined up in the backfield.
I was thinking J.J. Watt.
J.J. Watt goes back there. You don't really want to see that guy coming at you in a lead blocking situation.
No. The elephant package. And in this case, Lake Forest steps back to throw to the corner. Going to be way over his receiver's head. Nice pressure by the Scots. He had several players.
58 and 55. Brogney and Bartz.
Nice pressure. They really stepped up. I think that was, I'm at least a little surprised that we didn't see another run in that situation. And Calster, thankfully, was not overly surprised. They did a nice job with the coverage.
And maybe Lake Forest is thinking there, hey, we've hit them pretty hard in the middle here with a couple of runs. Maybe they're going to sell out, stop that. We can get a favorable matchup on the ends. But great defense by Mack and covering that thing up.
So this time they pull out that big halfback, and now you've got
Edlund back there. He's going to get the ball.
And we're going to wait for the call.
And
say touchdown. So that is going to be a touchdown for Lake Forest. Edlund with the rush. He did Blake Forrest with another nice drive. I mean, they were able to, you know, Macalester seemed to solve them a little bit their first drive, and the next two, you know, one was short field certainly, but one was a little bit longer.
I think we've seen three crucial third down pickups, which has been a big deal. And, you know, if you're obviously on the Lake Forest sideline, you're happy to see that. But Mac allowing some big third down gains.
And here comes the extra point attempt. Kick is up and good. Lake Forest will go ahead 14 to 6, an 8-point lead. I had the math right at some point. Take a quick break with the teams while they line up for a kick. And coming back in, it's going to be Lake Forest with the kickoff. 12 minutes left in the second quarter. Lake Forest now goes ahead 14-6 over Mac.
Beatty's back deep now.
Yeah, that's an interesting one. That's starting to play one of your better athletes back there. Knee with the return. Got some room. Makes a man miss at about the 32-yard line and plows ahead for another 5 yards. Macalester will start the drive at the 37. Knee does a great job picking up those extra 4 or 5 yards of time, which that adds up over a season of better field position.
Good field position for Mac here. I think it's the best field position they've had all day. So we'll see how they come out here. I mean, they've thrown well. The coverage has been there. I think both times that Petrich has fumbled, it was pretty good coverage. Couldn't find a guy open. And the pressure eventually got to him, but it wasn't like the pressure was on him right away.
Now, he had that time to take one or two steps up in the pocket. I think what you're going to see now, I think Petrich's response may be to tuck and run a little faster in that situation. Stefan, nice running room. Right side of the line really must have sealed off as he made a nice cut from the left side. He's kind of running off the guard up the middle and then cut to the right side behind the tackle. So it's going to be first down for the Scots near midfield, just shy of the Lake Forest side of the field. Scots will have three wide receivers. Actually, I think four. They've got Strybeck is kind of tucked in line. Shifts over and they shift H-back back. That takes a snap, drops back, looks left, throws. And Beatty with the catch and kind of eludes a big tackle.
It was a big hit there by the DB, but Beatty just kind of spins out of it and
jumps for an extra yard
or two to give him the first down.
That's something, again, Beatty, we talked about him doing that the previous drive where he kind of fell forward right before the strip fumble. And does a nice job being able to catch, first secures the ball and then able to get down without giving it up even on a big hit like that.
Just a treat to watch. A guy with his kind of talent, and then obviously he's a smart football player.
Just under 11 minutes left. First half. Petrich, kind of a broken play. Steps around, nice elude job. He's got a little more time than he thinks, and just off the hands of Johnny Knee. Boy, Petrich, nice job. He had a defender get a paw on his back. Still able to step around.
Stefan trying to help. And he offered a little bit, but, you know, Petrich stepping away from that defender who came fairly clean around the edge. And had it not at least been for Stefan to slow him down a little bit, we might have seen a third sack. And as fast as he was coming, we might have seen a third fumble.
That's down to 10 on the play clock. Still getting lined up. Might see a timeout from the Scots right here.
Get it off.
They just get it off, and it's going to be another kind of broken play.
I don't know if that was. That I don't know if that is that draw that we were talking about, perhaps, because it looked like he tucked it pretty quickly. He faked like he was going to throw kind of that out pattern and then tucked it and ran forward. So it may have been a bit of a busted play, but it's something that I was certainly thinking might happen soon is, again, inviting those pass rushers up the field and then just trying to find a lane in the middle.
Yeah, we'll have to see. It seemed like they're playing Stefan sort of man-to-man on here. And so I think if you're going to run that draw, you got to flush him. You've got to send him in motion wide and get that middle linebacker spot cleared. Throw over the middle, Stefan with the catch. And they do send Stefan out into a pass pattern. And they picks up a big first down for the Scots. That gets him to just inside the 30-yard line.
This is very reminiscent of that first drive for the Scots. Just, you know, methodical, moving the ball down the field. They're in a position here on Lake Forest 30 where it just shouldn't surprise you to see them take a shot with Beatty, a shot to the end zone.
I mean, the thing we haven't seen the Scots do yet is punt. They've continued to move the ball all up until they've turned it over on the last two drives. See? Their offense is continuing to crank. Petrich throws the outside. Strybik the catch. Nice blocking ahead of him. And that's going to be number four for the Scots. Bresson, as well as Beatty, with some strong blocks on the outside. And the Scots pick up a first down. And Strybik, I mean, we've seen him pay it forward already with some of his blocking, so he gets the beneficiary, of some great blocking downfield by the Scots, but he also returns that at times.
Force checking in here, if they don't try to go something towards that far side on a possible sweep play.
5 seconds on the play clock.
Here comes Rapport. Timeout.
Yep, timeout to the Scots.
I don't think Coach Janison thought they were going to get that off. It was going to be pretty close. I mean, it was down to about a second left in the play clock right as Rapport was going to be in the position where he would either give the handoff or Petrich fake it to him.
As you said, it's kind of a fairly big set of plays right here. I mean, this is right where the Scots got down to the last drive before they lost the ball in the fumble.
It's big for a number of reasons, but you think, you know, if Matt can put it in here and kick the extra point, be 13-14, because Lake Forest gets the ball in the second half. They won the toss and deferred. So be really good for, obviously really good for Matt to put points up here. The whole playbook is pretty open here, you know, with a first down here from the 20-yard line. You can do a lot of things with what Coach Davies draws up here. Rapport's still back in there.
Gets it and goes in motion. He actually stops, goes right up the middle instead of cutting it wide, and he gets a gain of 5.
For 44, Johnny LaPont was on the outside there, and he stepped into the lane and was not going to allow Rapport to get outside of him. Great job just seeing that and taking what they do give you, and he turns that up, gets about 6. But they had that defended well. They were not going to let that get outside of the defense.
I'll tell you, especially on that one, I noticed it. You know, it's that's about 20 seconds down in a stance for the offensive line. That is tough. That's a lot of discipline to stay in that stance with all the, you know, the receivers are looking around. They're able to kind of relax, but the line is still down and at the block. Rapport gets the ball, kind of goes outside. Stefan with the block. We're pulled down from behind, gain of 2, and that's going to bring up a big 3rd down and 3 coming up.
Good pursuit by Lake Forest there. Stop that play short of a first down.
And so Macalester getting the play call in. Seconds left on the play clock. Stefan will be behind Petrich. 4 wideouts, and he got 2 very dangerous ones near side, and Strybik and Beatty.
The option.
Look, yeah.
There's going to be a penalty flag down, though. I wonder what that's going to be. That's going to be a hold.
like it's in the interior of the line.
That's why I'm thinking it might be a hold or a chop. Not backing it up. Now they're backing it up a little bit.
Personal foul. Stop the line. Number 6871. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay, third down.
But yeah, Petrich is shimmy shake in the middle of the field might be opening the playbook up. That was we haven't necessarily seen some of that kind of straight option. I mean, that was sort of a misdirection option play to the outside.
It was a triple option. He has the option to give it to the first guy through. He didn't, takes it, and then they go on kind of that traditional option around the left. But that penalty, gosh, that is a momentum killer.
I mean, we've seen Shosie hit out to, I think, they've got to get the ball down about 7-8 yards to give Shosie a chance on this. That's probably the goal right here.
Debate the other middle.
Over the middle.
That's going to be a pass interference call, though. Scott's going to pick up a first down on this. That was a little early on the coverage. So Lake Forest pretty excited about the interception, but that's going to be all for naught, and Mac's going to pick up a first down. Yeah, well, whatever the penalty is, even if it's an illegal contact, it's still going to be. It's still going to be a first down.
So that gives the Scots new life. I mean, the Scots chop block put him in a very tough spot and bailed out by Lake Forest. That is shaping up to be a pretty nice play, Beatty over the middle.
Yeah, without the hold, I mean, I think you see a first down for Beatty because he couldn't get his hands up because they were being held down, and so that's why he didn't get a clean chance at catching the ball. It hits off him, and you got tip drill, and the safety picks it off. So having Beatty down there, again, it's just a weapon because he's so hard to cover. He runs such good route, and he's so athletic.
Beatty, the one that we've been talking about, is a wide receiver on the near side. Jonathan Knee in motion. Strybeck and Beatty all to the near side. Takes a snap, looks to that side, throws it out to the corner of the end zone.
That's got to be – that's very early contact again. Perhaps they're going to say that ball didn't have an opportunity to be caught in bounds, but that hit came certainly before the ball was ever near Beatty.
And I guess it was in the act of – reaching down to say incomplete. I thought he was pulling for the flag.
And I don't know that even if that contact doesn't happen, I don't know that Beatty can pull that down in bounds. But it's certainly early contact.
It was another, that's a pretty good throw by Petrus. That's a tough one, far side of the field. And he really gave his receiver only a chance to make that catch. He's not going to get a turnover on that play.
Really good point. That ball was only going to be caught by the receiver, not a chance to be intercepted by the DB.
Jennison's going to take a minute to talk it over with the team. We'll take it with them. 6:10 left. Second quarter, big downs coming up. Scott, second and 10. And Scots now have the ball on their 18-yard line, second and 10 to go. Nice cover-up by Lake Forest. Scots tried to get a little tricky. Ran Rapura motion and then sent Beatty the opposite direction. Toss the ball to Beatty, and he's going to get tackled for a loss. That's going to end up being a loss of 7 on the play.
Jordan McInerney was having none of that. Great job. He came up the field and just kind of held his position. He didn't chase the pursuit.
And I think McInerney was the one that we talked about on the sack deep in Lake Forest territory that was in on the play.
Well, here we are. The Scots are almost in a similar position pre-holding call against the DB.
I actually think it's a shorter down to go because the stick moved a little bit after the penalties. There's a throw to the out. Oh, just a little bit off from knee, but knee would have been close to the sticks. Now the Scots have a very tough decision. We're going to see a flag on the play. Holding call is going to be declined. Fourth down. And looks like Scots are going to send out the field goal unit.
Chose is out there.
So this is a 43-yarder. And we've seen Chose hit, a 39 earlier this year, or 37. We saw something in that range, and he's had plenty of leg. Wind is a little bit, looks like right to left for him.
Tryback's late getting on the field.
Yep. Scots still have a lot of
plenty
time.
Plenty of time on the play clock.
Smith the hold, Chose the kick. There's the kick, low line drive, and another tough snap. Smith did a good job getting it down on the ground, but Chose, that line drive was, I don't think it ever got above the goalpost, and it's going to be ball over to Lake Forest. And another, I think it was probably the curse that I said where Scott's offense was rolling, but they had a really good run on offense, and it just all of a sudden petered out after they blocked below the waist ball.
Yeah, they got pushed back on that and then came back with a fortunate penalty, but then they couldn't really capitalize on that.
No, I mean, Lake Forest, we've seen them come up with some opportunistic turnovers, but then that was one of the first times that we saw their defense really dig their heels in and say, you're not coming forward on us. Run to the left side, and the Scots swallow it up quickly. Loss of 1 on the play. I do think one thing, Scots are probably, two to three inches and 20 pounds lighter on the defensive side of the line than the offensive side of the line compared to Lake Forest. But they are much quicker. Something like that where there's a lateral movement involved, the defensive line is much faster to get over to the ball.
Certainly.
Not necessarily at center as I look at it, but the guards and the tackles from these guys are big. Snap. And get a handoff to the fly person. And a tackle made by the Scots. Boy, not much of a gain on that. It looked like a much more promising play as it was unfolding.
We had really good pursuit there by Dane Koo Blake, who wasn't going to allow the guy to cut back upfield. And the cornerback on that side, I didn't see who it was, held his ground. He shed that block. That was number 16, Nathan Gottlieb. And Dane Koo Blake kind of just ran to the sideline, and then Gottlieb made that tackle. Really good pursuit there by Blake.
That's offside for a second and get back. Over to the sideline to see if there's any reaction. Ball, there's not.
Ooh.
There's a blitz from the outside. And that's going to leave the ball carrier open. Scots get the ball carrier down. It looks like it's going to be short, so 3rd and 6. They get a gain of 4, and now it's going to be 4th and 2. Likely a punt situation coming up.
That was Blake again coming around the edge. Barely untouched.
Both times that Blake's come around the edge, it's been on kind of a traditional passing play, so the quarterback's taken a couple of steps backward. We haven't necessarily seen it where they've tried to do some kind of a timing route or something, where it seems like Blake is maybe 2 steps short each time.
Certainly. We're going to take a timeout here as the play clock winds down, and they're going to talk about it.
First timeout.
We'll take it with Blake Forrest. Come back and just a few minutes as the Lake Forest punts the ball off. Andrew Smith back to return for the Scots. Punter for Lake Forest. Same as the place kicker, Michael Ballins. And they do a fake. And the person trips. That is very unlucky. I'll tell you what, short of the triple option run by, you know, Navy or Georgia Tech or the teams that run it, the choreography of a fake punt is fantastic. You know, I mean, it takes that little snap. You had about 10 little counter plays going on inside, and I mean that one, I think they had it if the guy doesn't trip.
Well, it's certainly going to be close.
Yeah,
but that's a break for the Scots. Lake Forest took a risk.
Yep, and Scott's working with a very short field on this one. It's going to be on the 36 of Lake Forest.
That's got to account for Beatty, where he is.
They've swapped Beatty up. Looks like he's on the far side now. Shots back, looks right side to Knee. Knee's going to be tackled after the catch.
Should be to the 31, though. Let's see what the...
Well, the far side has it spotted at 29.5. Yeah, so they give him a nice spot on that play, right where he actually caught it.
Yep. Great first down gain, big chunk right there. Now you got, you know, some options here on second down.
2.5 minutes left. Bresson in motion. You got a stack of receivers near side. Scott's going to throw it to Bresson. And good block. Looks like they're going to say Bresson stepped out after a couple steps. Nice little cut block. Might have been it was Knee and Strybeck on the blocks, but I think Knee had that little cut on the outside. Did a nice job. It's going to get the Scots a first down. And 10 yards to go. It's on the 24-yard line.
Got to the one timeout left here. So if they need to talk about something, this drive obviously is very key. They don't want to rush through too much if they don't have to. Here's Bresson.
That same pack of three receivers on your side. Hand off, Stefan. Rumbles ahead, gain of one or two on the play. Going to set up second down and 9 to go. Time Beatty will come near side with me. The side that we've seen Beatty be most effective on. Wouldn't be surprised if they roll everybody else off the other side and throw to him. Petrich. Snap. It's right side. There's the ball to Beatty.
It's going to get out of bounds too, but it's... No, they've got it. They got that first down. And an out of bounds.
About all you could want on that play, aside from putting it in the end zone. It'll be first and 10. That's have the ball in about the 13 yards. And like you said, the Scots would like to cook out this clock as well as put one in the end zone, because you really don't want to give the ball back to Lake Forest under any circumstance. Petrich takes a snap, looks left side, now down the middle. Pressure. I'll force him to scramble up the middle. He takes a loss of one or two, but this time Scots do hold on to the ball.
Big pressure coming around that right side of the offensive line, but Petrich pulls it down and holds on to it.
Clock running on the game clock, 45 seconds left, so it's a play clock. That's at 20.
A 24-second difference there.
Petrich, Stefan behind him. Three wide receivers far side, which is the wide side of the field. Petrich looks back to the right. Knee, nice comeback. I think he's got it.
That's six.
And
wow.
He does. Touchdown, Scots. Petrich to Knee.
Going to go for two, looks like. They're calling for two. They're going to try to tie this thing up.
Yeah, I think on this one, you know, this is a relatively different play than the previous one in terms of the amount of space that you have in some things. If you're the Scots and you knew you were going to go for two, this is a time to really press that time. Like, can you run? I would think run this faster, not give Lake Forest a chance to think about
sub
a difference.
Out or, yeah. or anything like that.
There's a difference between the two. Scots do line up fairly quickly, although the play clock now down to five. 25 seconds left. They're going to put Bresson in motion and
over
throw
the
over
middle.
The middle. They've got him. There's Beatty.
Surprise, surprise, Alec Beatty.
And there's a flag down middle of the field. Right, kind of camouflaged almost on the goal line. And we'll see. The umpire is talking to the referee. Ineligible player downfield on the Scots.
5-yard penalty. Replay the try.
Now they're going to replay the try.
It wasn't like that play took a long time to develop, so I don't know how a lineman gets downfield in that situation.
Must have completely overpowered his defender. That's a good question, Josh.
That call seems iffy to me, and that's just it's not like it's not like he's scrambling back there or they're doing a bunch of fakes. That was a pretty quick hitter. Nonetheless, they get flagged for it, and now they're going to have to try the point from 5 yards further back.
And this may be easier for them with the way they've been throwing the ball. Gives Beatty and Knee and company a little more space. Petrich shots back, looks to the corner.
They got it anyway.
There's the catch, yep.
Petrich has been on the money today. That ball right there could not have been thrown any better. The ball kind of back shoulder to Knee on the touchdown. He's on fire today, and everything is with precision, and so really got to credit him. The only, obviously the two times that we've seen him fumble the ball was hit from behind, so I think Petcher's having a great game despite the two fumbles. His throws have been fantastic today.
Yeah, it's a good way to put it. Pretty much everything that's been positive for the Scots on offense and everything that's stung a little bit has gone through Petrich on here, and it is not completely on Petrich or some of the pressures on that. He's made some nice plays to try to get away at the start of some things, but when he has time to throw the football and when he takes the opportunity to throw the football, he has done a great job. And as the weather gets colder and stuff, this isn't easy weather to have a ton of touch. He's done a nice job. He is much better than the Carlton game, I think, at some of those touch passes today.
Certainly.
Chosey will kick off for the Scots. He kind of sends a windmill, and Lake Forest will take a fair catch. That is a very new wrinkle in college football, so a fair catch at the 8.
It's taking me a long time to kind of get over. I'm like, what are you doing? Fair catch and a kick.
The ball was fair caught inside the 25-yard line. By rule, the ball will be placed at the 25-yard line. First down.
What's interesting, it doesn't take any time off the clock. That's a different way to play the clock game a little bit.
Right, it guarantees you 25, no clock, your point.
So Lake Forest has been a little bit more kind of a grinded-out offensive team, so now that they have to open it up a little bit, it'll be interesting to see what they do. I think this plays a little bit more into the Scots' defensive hands than it does into Lake Forest.
See that pass
offense.
Rush. Yeah. And here they come.
Throw over the middle. That's going to be a gain of 12 yards.
They're going to clock it. They've got the timeouts.
They did, and I think Lake Forest was quick enough to the line. They do such a good job getting to the line up there. They could have almost run the play. I don't think they needed to clock it. I think if they had been totally lined up and had a play called in, they could have just gone.
There was two pass rushers right in the face of the quarterback of Cleary on that play, and he holds on to it for a second longer. That's going to be a huge sack. We'll see if the Scots can continue to bring that pressure on the pass rush. Are they coming again?
Quarterback scrambles out of bounds. That cost half the clock time. I think they had 17 seconds.
Yeah, I'm surprised he didn't throw it away to keep some of that clock on, but that was Dan Kublik again coming around that right side of the line and just putting the pressure and forcing Cleary to step up and jog to the sidelines.
And I think it might have been number 17. There was somebody that was around the 40-yard line, middle of the field for Lake Forest, and I the player tracked the opposite way the quarterback did on that instead of flowing
yeah,
towards the sideline.
Stop and turn around, come back to him.
And I think he might have been open had he made that play a little bit. I think that's probably what the quarterback was trying to see. Is it somebody gonna
come break open?
Yep. If the play breaks up. 9 seconds is probably, what, two plays? And ball's up in the middle and almost caught by Lake Forest.
That was dangerous.
I think the coach would have said he planned that. Oh, it's going to be quite the play.
It was the planned hook and ladder, but instead of making the catch, he just bat it.
Just bat it, exactly. The Franco Harris play. But that's going to be 4 seconds. I happen to think it's fourth down. I think you got to kick it, maybe?
I don't know.
This
that
is a weird one.
That Lake Forest can just seems more dangerous than
– yeah.
There's just more risk than benefit on this play, unless they're just going to hand it off and –
run.
Yeah.
Run, don't fumble. And there's a throw.
I mean,
down.
Even that play. The.
Well, let's see. Andrew Smith, nice play. I think they're going to say out of bounds, and that's the easy thing for the referees to say.
Yeah, even that play. We got a flag in the backfield. Are we going to have a rough in the passer?
Oh, boy.
Yeah, you're going to have it.
Oh, boy.
Brogni must have put
a
late hit or something on it.
Now, if you're the quarterback and you get the victory formation kneel on this, are you upset?
you just took a shot.
Yeah,
you just
exactly.
took a shot. Now they're going to say, let's go into half. But
yeah.
Based on the throws that we've seen, I mean, now maybe the quarterback can get it to the end zone. But from where the line of scrimmage was on the last play, he can't get that to the end zone. So they're hoping for a pass interference or break a tackle or something.
Well, basically something like what the Scots did the last play.
Yeah. And really to me, there's just too much risk involved here versus reward. There's the hook and ladder. That's a fumble, though.
And the Scots able to maybe pick it up. Somebody picked it up.
Somebody got it.
Down.
The half's over. Oh, I got a flag.
And I do think
there's
that
a flag. We got some extracurricular activity.
Yeah, it's quite the swarm. I do think that play was the same one they were trying to set up when the guy had a pop off his shoulder.
He just didn't catch it.
Yeah, he just didn't catch it.
I'll be curious to see who gets this flag. I think if it's against the Scots, I wonder if it extends the half.
Yeah? That's a good question. Hopefully, I mean,
it's going to be a dead ball foul.
Yeah, being a slight homer, I'm kind of hoping it's an offsetting and we just pack it up and go.
Going to the locker room.
Scots must believe that's what it is.
Oh, no, they're getting stopped. Oh,
yeah.
There goes Lake Forest. So that's.
I mean, maybe it's going to be a 7-on-7 passing game play at this point. The rest of the teams are left.
Maybe we'll get out there.
Yeah. you could have the team managers play. I mean, there's a lot of options for this.
They've got to be offsetting. That's. Oh, it's going to be on the kick.
Lake Forest, number 55. That foul will be enforced on the second half kickoff.
Oh, yeah. That'll make it easy. That'll make it interesting, then.
Well, that can almost guarantee that Lake Forest will start the second half from the 25-yard line.
25-yard line, yeah, no kidding.
Because I think Chose can put it through the back of the end zone,
yeah,
getting
exactly.
15 extra yards.
15 extra.
Pretty good half of football there.
Yeah, I mean, if you're the Scots, you have to be really encouraged by the offense. They, like you said, they all except for one instance where the Scots were stopped, they churned down the field.
Right, and, you know, having the two turnovers and being able to overcome those and go into halftime tied, I think, yeah, that's a good thing. And you saw some really good signs on offense from the Scots. They played pretty good defense. There was a short field on the one turnover that they couldn't defend. I think the Scots have played well. I think Lake Forest played well. It was a really good half of football, and I think it sets up for a great second half.
Yeah, so stick around and get to watch the Edina band at halftime here, something we don't normally have, and it's exciting to watch and get a chance to have the teams make some adjustments in the next 20 minutes for the second half of football.
We'll be back.
independent because they all need each other in order to perform everything they do. They recognize the importance of their part and know they are a part of something much bigger than themselves. They take care of each other and help each other succeed to the best of their abilities. You could say that our students are the Mike. You to join us on this Thursday, October 4th, as the Edina Hornet Marching Band is a free outdoor show at our very own Coleman Stadium, 6:30 p.m. It's a family-friendly event to get an up-close, personal, and free performance of the Pride of Edina. Next up, we will feature our Edina Hornets while we play What I Like About You by the Romantics. Thank you.
coming back in. It's going to be Macalester kicking off to Lake Forest. Macalester, we'll have to see how they play this. I always wonder on this, Josh, right? So there was a personal foul at the end of the half after the time stopped. It was on Lake Forest. Macalester's now going to be kicking off from the 45, or excuse me, the 50. So if you're Macalester, do you put this through the back of the end zone, or do you try to put this on the one?
Or do you, I mean, well, the one certainly there's the fair catch thing, but do you onside kick here? Given that even if you don't get it, you're giving him the ball at the 40.
That's a great question.
15. I mean, it's 15 yards from that touchback spot, but maybe this is the chance that you would gamble on something like an onside kick.
That's an interesting one. And the squib. Okay.
That's
an interesting one because that. With the guy not doing the fair catch.
You can't fair catch a squib.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you saw, but it hit, the first guy did touch it. So if that hits him and bounces away and one of the Scots guys jumps on it, I mean, that's certainly, the squib is a pretty good way to go right there.
Yeah, good play. I mean, Scots generally have been pretty good the last few years at adjusting at halftime. This will be interesting. I think, you know, Josh, you pointed out a number of times how much pressure the Scots got have been 1 to 2 steps away from the quarterback. So let's see if they can convert a few of those.
I think that's close.
The big one for Coach Mullenbach. How do we actually convert the sack?
Right. Oh, that's a good route.
Yep, throws down the field, and Miles is going to have to make the tackle, and he does. Nice one-on-one tackle by Keontae Miles at the 40.
That was number 8, two of them. That's John Rawl on the stop-and-go route. He got the defender to bite on the stop. Well, that's a huge.
Rawl is actually limping off at about 30 right now. Hope it's okay. Got taken down a bit hard.
So here they are at the 40. Say you tried the onside kick and missed it. This is where it would be.
Yeah, they were one play away from that spot. Out route and a big hit. Andrew Smith and Keontae Miles combined for the lick. That was on number 83. Teddy Crane, the guy behind John Rawl in the depth chart.
Back to that kick, you know, I've also seen it where, and I don't know if it's done on purpose or if it's an accident, where the kicker just kicks a low line drive and hits one of the front men that turn around to go block.
Like Shosie's second extra point attempt, right?
Yeah, I mean, that would have been it. Yeah,
10-foot laser. There's a handoff and Lake Forest running the ball up the middle, and that's going to be Alex Adams rumbling ahead. Boy, both Adams and Edlin, the two running backs, are just stout, if you will.
They don't seem like guys that are gonna break it for a long one, but man, they look like they're hard to bring down.
Yeah, the going back to your reference, Tennessee football, the guy that comes to mind, who was he played for? And there's Adams.
You know what,
the right
Jamal
side.
Lewis.
Jamal Lewis. Yep. That's the name I was going for. That's the guy it reminds me of, right? He threw up some unbelievable numbers in the NFL, but it was never seemed like he was going to outrun somebody. But you got to get more than a paw on him to bring him down.
Yeah. Strong runners.
Yep. Now Lake Forest kind of doing what Scots have done in
stretches.
They
flipped this field quickly.
Yeah, they're chewing up 10 yards of play. There's play fake downfield. Nice head fake by the quarterback. Completion. And great attempt. Gets the touchdown for Lake Forest. So Lake Forest, in the span of 4 or 5 plays, goes the whole length of the field after really we spent a long time talking about a great kickoff by the Scots. And Lake Forest just braced all that advantage for the Scots very quickly.
They hit two huge pass plays that looked like stop and goes or pump fake. And the defensive backs kind of sat on those routes and the receiver got behind him both times. So they get two big chunk plays on those.
It really seems like, again, that was a bit of a shift for Lake Forest. They've kind of been short with the pass plays, hard up the middle with the run, and all of a sudden they continue the hard up the middle with the run, but now the pass plays are hitch and goes.
They open up the outsides and hit them big. Well, that was quite an impressive first drive of the second half for Lake Forest. And Macalester defense, they're going to have to figure out what went wrong there and make an adjustment quickly because they obviously can't allow drives like that the rest of this game. But I'm confident they will. Coach Mullenbach will make the adjustments. He'll see what happened there in that drive. And I don't think you're going to see Macalester give up points that easily going forward the rest of this game.
No, and the major difference, the thing the Scots haven't gotten is a turnover. And if the Scots are going to do that, it's probably going to be out of the secondary. Miles and Smith back. It's going to be picking off a pass, a tip, something like that. Lake Forest wants to open it up and throw. That's going to be what's going to hinge this game, I think. Some sort of a momentum play like that for Scott's defense. I think Scott's always going to probably take care of the ball pretty well, move it up the field. Defense has to get one or two of those. I don't know if they're going to completely stop Lake Forest dead, but they've got to get something that, something like what Lake Forest did in the first half with their defense. Two opportunistic turnovers.
Two
plays that just cut off the drive immediately.
Ooh, I wonder if that ball was going out of bounds.
That's a good question. I have never understood how Shosi tends to hit these flat helicopter kickoffs. And I always wonder when you're the other team, how do you judge going towards the 5-yard line, you let it bounce or not? Because I'd probably be more aggressive and let's see what happens. But
well, you got to judge quickly because that the coverage team is coming down, and obviously that's a live ball. So if you know, make that decision too late, and then you let it bounce, and then it doesn't actually get into the end zone, well, you risk the other team recovering it and being first and goal from the 5.
Yep. Petrich in the backfield for the Scots. Take the snap. Hand off to Stefan up the middle. He goes right side and is tackled after gain of 5. Nice movement. Scots are going to have 2nd and 5. Just as we're kind of getting this, the second half up and rolling, just a couple notes on here. You know, Scots had really great, first 2 games of the season. We covered the first one here with Carlton, but the second game, actually, a really nice game with Hamlin. Scots won, and Scots again, 2nd year in a row, they've swept the trophy games for them. They played Hamlin, they played Carlton, former MIAC opponents won both. Really exciting thing for them to pull off 2 years in a row. Last year was the first year we'd ever done both, so this is the first year we've ever gotten 2 in a row. Play action, Petrich pulls the ball down and runs. He's hit by several Lake Forest defenders. I think if you're the Macalester coach, that's where you want to see Petrich put his head down and just run, is in the middle of the line like that.
You know, the pursuit got to him pretty quickly. I mean, it was there for a split second, if that, and then the pursuit caught up pretty quickly. We lost the band.
Yeah, that's right.
I was just poking my head out of the booth here.
We
don't hear any band.
Well, yeah, and I, for a little while, I saw there were, I think, 6 yellow buses out behind the baseball and softball fields where they were all staging them out there.
Well, it was
fun
while it lasted.
Fun while it lasted. That was a great atmosphere. I think Edina's band said they have something going on Thursday night of this week at their stadium. So great to see people support them. We enjoyed having them here.
We did. That was brought a lot of fun atmosphere. They were great, and their halftime show was very well done as well. And so thank you to the Edina marching band for coming out and joining us today.
So pass over the middle is incomplete to Beatty, just a bit behind Beatty off his hands, and now Shosi will line up the punt for the Scots. First time we've seen Shosi punt today. Kind of tells you how the offense was in the first half. They were go, go, go until either a score or a turnover. Josie's punt, nice punt. End over end drives the returner back. And it looks like he called for a fair catch.
He's going to get it about the 24, looks like. Well, we'll see what kind of adjustments Coach Molenbuck's defense has made here and see if they can keep Lake Forest off of the board and get the football back for their offense.
Talked about, I think we mentioned this last time with Carlton. Good note here about junior defensive lineman Ethan Levin. So Levin, I believe, got mentioned a number of weeks ago, like 3 weeks ago in the Star Tribune, which is a big paper here in Minneapolis, about some of his efforts about preventing sexual violence and what it means, how you can make an impact through athletics. With improving the way people think about that. And he just got named to the All-State Good Works. That's a really exciting thing. It's actually been something that's been in Macalester's program a little bit. I know David Melms got named to that. He's going to get to, I believe, go to Melms. Went to the Sugar Bowl in January and get noticed. It's really fun to see them up there with, they pick folks from across D1, 2, and 3, and see guys get recognized for great effort along with football.
Well, it speaks to the type of character of Macalester football players who, are just amazing students who are doing really awesome stuff, and then doing things like what Levin is. You know, certainly it's very important work that needs to be done, and I think to use his platform that he has as a college football player to reach out to high school football players to get that that discussion going, it's much needed, certainly much appreciated, and it makes me proud to be a Macalester alum, and not only a Macalester alum, but alum of the athletic program as well, to see someone doing that and taking something like that seriously and doing something about it. So proud of Ethan and what he's doing.
The pass deep downfield, and there was the Scots' chance at a turnover. Even still, defense holds on a 3rd-and-7 play.
Yeah, we start talking about Levin there and kind of missed on some of the action, but great defensive stop there by the Scots to get the football back.
So we'll have a punt here. We've got a little bit of a switch now. You got Johnny Nee going back to turn instead of Andrew Smith. So we'll see if this is Smith, a very good athlete, certainly as well, but chance that's to create a good field off the kick. Flag thrown.
Oh, we got a block. The ball was blocked.
Tip ball. That will be down at about the 40. Nice roll for Lake Forest off of the tip.
Concern here, though, with the timing of that flag is, was Macalester onside? You know, about pre-snap where they lined up. It looked like, with the way that the flag was thrown and the timing, that there was a player maybe in the neutral zone or jumped the gun just a bit.
So they were talking to Jennison, I wonder.
Yeah,
if
it could also
a
be a procedural penalty as well.
Yeah, some sort of an illegal formation.
Illegal formation.
Procedural penalty, yep.
5 out of the backfield. That 5-yard penalty.
What's the mindset of the official there? Because obviously he sees it early. Is he just waiting, like, oh, I gotcha.
I don't know. You know,
until you shift or whatever.
It's a good one. I do know, you know, from our time doing the chain gang, Josh, there's a lot of communication between the receivers and the guy that's whatever the two officials are that are lined up on the line of scrimmage on the wide side. So I do know there's a lot of communication. That's where you see him with a handout or you know, trying to see if they're on. Alec Beatty was just doing right there to the line judge, trying to see if they're on or off. But it's interesting because the guys inside a little bit more
right.
aren't always checked.
Well, it's just they don't have the – I don't know if there's the ability to even make that communication, to ask that question.
Yeah.
The wide guys are usually pretty close to the official and can holler at him.
Well, the other thing is the linemen. I mean, Macalester guys are a good step off the line.
Yeah. Patrick, oh, they're going deep.
Deep ball, trying to go to Beatty, double covered. And ball is batting around for a minute, and great coverage by Lake Forest, number 31 for Lake Forest in on the play. That's Anthony Reek.
It was great coverage by 31 Reek, and then when the ball got there, it was great coverage by Beatty because
yeah.
that ball was looked like it was going to go the other way, and Beatty able to wrestle it out of the hands of the defender to make this second down and 10 versus first and 10 going the other way.
Second and 10, like to see Macalester kind of cut down the size of the chains here on this play a little bit. 10:33 left, third quarter. Lake Forest up 21-14. They had a very fast scoring drive on their first possession. It looks like a planned run, and he's going to plow ahead for a gain of 6.
It seemed, again, kind of like a draw play, a fake play. Let the outside guys rush up the field. Make a throw, and he had a lane open.
Big third and 4 coming up.
You know, I don't know that I've seen a sideline like Lake Forest's right now. These guys are, maybe Miami, but when they get turnovers and the turnover chain comes out,
yeah.
you see a lot of dancing like that.
Yeah.
But here on the third down, they're trying to create their own crowd noise.
Yeah.
Got to do what you can when you're on the road.
Well, I was going to say, it is a big play, and somehow, Stefan picks it up off the bounce. That was more rugby than football. He corrals it out of bounds. And the Scots are going to bring out the punt unit on 4th-and-5. And you're right, Josh. I mean, probably some combination of staying warm and staying into the game. I mean, they were in the warm locker room for 20, somewhat warm locker room minutes. And now you've been standing around for a little bit out here. So, but it was a pretty pivotal play, and their defense responded accordingly.
Yeah. Had a great stop there. Stefan couldn't handle the option pitch, and so that negated any opportunity for him to
make the play downfield. So Jose on to punt again.
O-line drive, and that's going to go into the end zone. Unlucky bounce for Chosey. It did not kind of pop up at all. And that's going to be Lake Forest ball 25. And, Josh, the one thing to tie up that Levine thing we were talking about a little bit with it, I, you know, with this isn't to dive too deep on some weak and Washington things, but there were a number of articles about sports and the combination of some of the attitudes this week, Senate hearings and things. It's really good to see somebody like Levine stimulating positive, direct conversation with things, because it is decoupling this idea that sports leads to anything like that or involves anything like that, and also make sports positive, implement, and change. So it's just really fantastic to see that kind of thing.
I think you hit it. It's a guy using his platform, right?
Yeah.
And you think, oh, Division III sports, you know, No one, you know, it's not a big deal or whatever. But you know what? He's a college football player. He's using his experience as a college football player, talking to high school players. And really, I think the message is, guys, this is important, and this is stuff that we need to stop. And I think you're right. Decoupling sports with that kind of behavior, I think, is big. And showing people that, hey, you know, if you're an athlete, it doesn't necessarily mean that you behave that way.
It's absolutely.
You know, I saw Levin the other day. I live in the neighborhood. He was walking to school. I was a little starstruck when I saw him. He's getting a lot of a lot of media attention.
Yeah.
I just saw he was in a list of 25 entrepreneurs under the age of 25 here in the Twin Cities. I saw him, and I wanted to say hi, but I was just a little starstruck.
Yeah, there you go. That's right. It's funny how that works, because you don't you know, one of the guys that I was involved with coaching on the baseball team was on Fox News this morning. He was on Fox and Friends.
Okay.
Nate Rubin.
Okay.
As a Democratic strategist, and was commentating.
Oh, wow.
And like, you know, those are just routine interactions you have here that lead to things down the road. It's really fun. I mean, you know, the guy out there, I think that was, what, Andrew?
Business.
Got it.
It's working now.
Meet with Coach Mullenbach at some point, so it's really exciting stuff. There's play down the field. Smith in coverage. Nice catch. Over the shoulder. Great throw by Lake Forest as well, and their offense is back on track.
That was an impressive pitch and catch, because the coverage was there. You mentioned Smith on the coverage, and he was there, had tight coverage, but the quarterback threw a nice ball, and the receiver brought it down.
Cleary takes the ball and is going to give the handoff. Nope, we're going to have the whistle. Plays blown dead.
Lake Forest trying to push the tempo there after that big hitter. They jumped back to the line and got ready. And I don't see any penalty flag, so I haven't really. The official marked the ball ready for play before the snap. Curious to see what's going to happen here.
Yeah, and the time I've seen this a few times has been when they don't let the defense sub, and I don't know if Lake Forest subbed in that process, possibly.
Well, the official is not supposed to mark the ball ready for play until the defense has been given an opportunity to sub if the offense subs. Well, it certainly looked like the official who was standing over the ball marked the ball ready for play as he stepped back. And
that's
obviously it wasn't. And the coach here, Lake Forest coach, wants an explanation as to what happened here.
And that's not something these are the teams Macalester's played over the last number of years. I haven't seen a team that truly pushes it at sort of a Oregon or Memphis or some of these other teams that push the tempo. I haven't seen anybody who's really tried to push the gas pedal that much, but that's got to be tough on the officiating crew, because these guys aren't used to that.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to be.
If you're an officiating crew and you draw an Oregon game, you better have your cardio in.
Yeah, exactly. First and 10 on the 35 for Lake Forest. Snap, bobbled snap for a minute. And there's a throw out to the flat. And Scott's able to get the ball carrier down, but not until a gain of 6. It's going to be second and 4.
I'll tell you, Cleary, the senior quarterback, is really showing some poise and some leadership here in this second half. There he takes a snap, bobbles it. He's able to come down with it,
but then knows where his checkdown receiver is. Everything else is closed or is covered up. Just hits his checkdown.
The throw to the corner. Macalester, chance to pick it off, and they do. Number 20 for Macalester. Cooper Tunack with the pick. And that was that. That's that kind of hinge play that we were talking about a little bit. You know, the Macalester's defense didn't really stop him too much, but they chose a great time to be opportunistic and pick a ball off.
You know, I just praised Cleary seconds before that, and then he grossly underthrows a ball, and Tunack is there to pick that off. That's the break that I think you were talking about earlier. That Scott's defense is going to have
to. Let's go! Make a play! Get it back! Look at that!
Pass complete to Jonathan Knee, 10 yards on the play. First down, first and 10 for the Scots on their own 20. Tell the keeper. Tackled by Dom Johnson.
Let's go, be smart! Let's go!
Alright, I'm all set. Can you hear me or and are you getting image?
Petrich to Alec Beatty. 15 yards on the play. First down, first and 10 for the Scots. On their own 39. Beatty incomplete. Jeremy Brown, the coverage.
Dragging him down by his jersey to hold.
Petrich pass complete to Jed Buckles. 9 yards on the play. Third down, 1 yard to go. Jeremy Steph on the carry. 2 yards on the play. Tagaba Lapont. First down, first and 10 for the Scots at the 50.
I can hear you now. I guess, can you hear me?
Okay.
Oh, nice. Say again. Come again.
Petrich to Jeremy Steffen. 12 yards on the play.
I'm just getting a lot of beeps, and every once in a while when you ask me if I can hear you.
First down, first and 10 part. For the Scots. At the Foresters, 38.
Just getting a lot of beeps right now. I can't find anything. Oh, the beep stopped.
Petrus pass in the first. Jack Strybeck incomplete.
Oh, you're back? Nope.
Petrus pass in for Reese Preston incomplete. Third down and 10.
I think we're just going to have to live with the beeps.
Jonathan Neen. Dom Johnson, the coverage. Fourth down, 4 yards to go. Pass complete to Jack Strybeck. Fourteen yards on the play. First down, first and 10 for the Scots. At the 16.
Let's go, defense! We have a play to win!
Same spot and a flag on the play. I expect that to be possibly roughing the passer.
Yeah, I think this is going to stand for 6.
Big touchdown, boys. Strybeck, last 2 catches over the middle. Petrick and Strybeck have connected. Ball official.
Penalty will be
Now they're going to get another kickoff starting at the 50-yard line.
I would like to see the line drive attempt. I have to be honest. I love that idea. Because I think if you're the offense after the last kick, you gotta hold your ground for a second, right? I mean, it's not like you're hitting a retreating person.
You can't just turn around and run when
Chaussion for the kick. This has been the thing Scott struggled with. They were 0-for-2 on the extra point. Extra point and a field goal. And Chaussion this time puts it right through. Yep, good to see him back on track. That may come into play later in the fourth quarter.
Well, it probably shouldn't surprise us much the way the first half went here. Now in the second half, seeing both teams go on an extended drive that covers the entire field. These two teams have just been kind of hitting and, you know, kind of punching and counterpunching all game. And so it really shouldn't surprise us that Mac just ripped off that big drive there to tie this thing back up. Just a really great game again. You know, these two teams, I think, are evenly matched. They're playing well, and it's certainly giving us an entertaining football game to watch.
Yeah, I don't think they're going to have the – before leaving the house today, a bit later than I probably should have, but before leaving the house, I was looking at the scores crawl, and it was Texas Tech and West Virginia. And I think West Virginia was up 28-7 at the start of the second quarter. And that game's going to have some horrific defense. And I don't think these teams are cruising for something along that, but the offenses have pretty much had their way today. They've extended it. They haven't played at that frenetic tempo that some of those Big 12 teams can play at like that. Shosie goes deep. Let's take out Chris Mitchell action shot. the defenses, it's really going to be, you know, Max pulled off one turnover. I think Lake Forest has had two. I think it's going to be the team that pulls off the next one from a defensive. It's going to be the one team that kind of gets that stop. It's probably going to be the one that wins. Offenses are doing a nice job. They feel like they're pretty comfortable right now.
Yeah, I think both offenses probably are pretty happy with where they're at, and they're still pretty comfortable being able to move the football. So I think you're right. Maybe it's going to come down to a big turnover in the second half or just a big stop, you know. Which defense can step up here in the second half and create a stop when it's needed.
Snap, Lake Forest surveys the field. Scott's get pressure.
Pressure finally got to him.
And they'll get a sack for 1.5 yards.
Well, the guy that caused the problem was Bartz coming around the end. He was the first to get to the quarterback. He was the one that brought him down, but he made him pull the football down and look for an alley, and there was nothing. There was no running lanes for him to go to.
So second and 11 coming up. And there's a throw to the outside. Lake Forest had good blocking set up, and the Scots quickly converge. And that's going to bring a big third down, 3rd and 6.
When Macalester's going well on defense, that's what you're seeing. You're seeing a zone defense that is predicated on pursuit. And it's, you know, let them catch underneath routes, let the pursuit flow to that. So when they're going well, you see that. And right there, you had four defenders on that ball pretty quickly.
Teams will let the clock run out. End of the third quarter, 21 points apiece between the Scots and the Foresters. Fourth quarter coming up. Lake Forest has a big 3rd and 6 coming up when we're back for fourth quarter action. And coming back into play, big 3rd and 6 coming up. Lake Forest quarterback barking out some commands to his team. He drops back. They
screen.
Set up a screen.
And that is covered well.
Yep, Macalester immediate coverage. Looked like number 55 for the Scots in on the play.
Bartz.
Josh Bartz. Boy, that name, Josh, I've heard you mention that
he
now
a
couple times.
He had a great series right there on the sack on that first down play. He was the first guy to the ball. Then right there he reads the screen perfectly. So he's going to go to the bench feeling pretty good about himself and really helping lift his defense to a huge stop right there.
And this is one of the things I was just picking up looking at Bartz, and there's a return, a knee tries to return, it gets maybe a yard or two. This Brownell Talbot on the Scots roster, same school for four of the Scots players, Runnels, Scott, Josh Bartz, and Rapport, all went to the same high school in Omaha. So a little bit of a recruiting hotspot.
Yeah, and they're all you know, feature players too.
Yeah.
So you know,
yeah,
you're able to get some starters from that same high school. I wonder what that school visit was like. I mean,
man, that's a heck of an ROI. I mean, whoever got that better have gotten there. But you know, if that was Marshall or if that was Coach Davies, that should have gotten them a bonus for recruiting trip.
Whoever covers Nebraska.
Yeah, exactly.
Wrestled those guys away from the Cornhuskers.
That's right. Well, Scots will take over. They're at their own 44-yard line. 14:15 left in the ball game. 21 apiece on the scoreboard. Throw to the outside. Nice throw to Beatty. He'll be tackled out of bounds, but after a gain of 8 or 9 yards.
He just means so much to this offense. I mean, he's a safety valve for Petrich, but not just that. He can run a deep pattern as well and be a huge hit for him. He just serves so many purposes in this offense. He kind of, as well as Petrich's throws, I mean, it's kind of Beatty that makes this thing go.
Yeah, see, and just like they did on this play, the most dangerous thing is when they leave him out on his own. Because you have to shield your help. And you have a nice block.
Stephen.
Yep, nice block by Beatty to spring Stephen. He was able to pinch off the corner. And Stephen made a great one-on-one move to kind of get to the side of the first tackler. And Scott's now deep in Lake Forest territory. They're going to have the ball at the 29. Yeah, I mean, three years ago, Beatty had come in and he was kind of a really athletic quarterback. They did with some option packages, played safety for the Scots, and did a little bit of wide receiver work. And now he's shifted to be this really strong wide receiver, Scots. So he's filled multiple roles over his time here in St. Paul. Petrich surveys the field, takes the snap. There's a handoff to Stephen. They're going to throw it.
He caught it.
Wow.
Johnny
How did
Knee.
He get that? That was incredible. Johnny Knee with the catch. Stephen with an even more magical throw than Petrich has ever had somehow between two defenders to Johnny Knee.
You know, Knee was the only guy looking at the football. Yeah. And really, if the defender turns around, that's probably defended. I mean, it was not a great ball. But when you only have one guy looking at the football, he's the only guy that have a chance to catch it.
That's why I don't understand how it wasn't defended with the guy's back. How it got through his back was incredible. That'd be an interesting one with the upgraded cameras we're using to see if we can zoom in on that a little bit. There's Petrich, a bit of a play fake. He scrambles around. Lots of pressure on him. There's a throw to the corner.
He's just going to get rid of that.
Yep. Good play. And tackled again late.
But right in front of the referee, so referee's not going to miss that one.
Yeah, I was going to say, if there's something there, would have been called. And second down, it was quite a lot of work for an incompletion. Going to be 5 yards to go for the score, 12-27, with the game tied up at 21 apiece.
You know, Beatty one-on-one outside.
That's got to be where the ball's
wide.
Got to be where the ball's going. Strivick's got to cut inside and go to do something with Beatty on the outside. Nope. Petrich will keep, and he's going to try it on his own. You have a flag down.
We're going to have a face mask.
And Beatty in for the touchdown, I believe. And a hold on the Scots.
The reason why I thought it was a face mask, where he threw that penalty flag when he threw it, I didn't see any Macalester blockers in that area.
Yeah, well, he had some funny movements. It might have just been him, but he had some funny movements there at the beginning of the play as he dodged past a defender.
Well, that's certainly is a bummer for the Macalester offense. Going to back them up 10 yards. And they were knocking on the door, and you know, still they're deep in territory. But when you have to move back 10 yards, it's a kind of a hit to your offense.
Yeah, I'm surprised again that. I mean, I'd probably go for three throws to Beatty here. Now they've got a number of folks over on his side, which is not one we've seen him throw to him very much. Petrich, step back. He is looking left, and there he throws to Beatty. There's the catch and the touchdown, even through the pass interference.
That was a beautifully thrown football. I mean, it was in the only spot that, I mean, Beatty was the only guy that was going to catch that football where that spot was. He works through the defender.
Yeah, I would go back to, you know, Josh, I think we talked about it. The Scots are going to line up for the extra point. And we'll call that one here for a second. Smith to hold and Shosie to kick. And this is a big one, frankly, for the Scots because they've struggled a little bit on this today.
The exchanges haven't been great between the long snapper and the holder. That one's perfect, set down perfectly. And you can't draw that one up any better than that.
I would go back to the play we were talking about. There was a play in the might have been the first quarter where Petridge put one down the corner for Johnny Knee, and he threw it to where Knee had half a chance at it. It might have been early contact, and ball, though, was placed somewhere where only Knee was going to catch the ball. And it was very much the same type of throw, same type of touch and precision that happened on that play, Josh.
And
like
it looked like, the same, possibly the same route here on this play as that one. That's good thinking. And, you know, we said that, you know, Beatty makes a lot of this offense work, and certainly a ton of credit goes to Petridge. But it just seems like, you know, when you know your receiver's going to get there, going to get to the spot and battle through it, it gives you a little more confidence in throwing it. So obviously the chemistry is there between Petridge and Beatty, and they've shown off some pretty good chemistry today, as they have, you know, in the other games this year, in those first two against, you know, Carlton and Hamlin last week, obviously being shut out by Monmouth. But the chemistry between those two guys is impressive, and they continue to show up and play well.
Kickoff fielded by Lake Forest, and the Scots are going to have the returner down at about the 23. Nice coverage job by the Scots. Scots players kind of flying out of the tackle range for a little bit of excitement. I think there's definitely some feeling of a little bit of momentum on the Scots part. That was a good stand on the defensive side, and then they put a nice drive together. 28-21, Scots are ahead after the touchdown.
And it goes back to, I mean, we said Bart's name a lot. He was such a key player in that defensive stop. And we said, you know, maybe it's going to come down to a turnover or a big stop. And that certainly happened the last time Macalester was out there on defense. And they turned it into 7 points.
Now Macalester has to figure out how much have they doused the momentum. And they got a nice stop in play right now. And a good gang tackle by the Scots. They had about six guys over at the ball. And I know Coach Mullenbach has always said that's really the sign of when his defense is playing well, is that they have multiple guys convert.
Dean Smith did a great job fighting through the block on that screen play. He didn't make the tackle, but he was the first to get a hit on the receiver after fighting through a block. Slowed him down enough, to your point, Cormick, to allow the pursuit to catch up and clean that play up.
Snap. And you're going to have a throw kind of on the bubble screen type idea. And nice blocking set up by Lake Forest. In fact, the ball was on the floor for a minute. Picked up by the receiver.
Well, linesman's got it going back to Lake Forest. The big fellow was out there on that one. Big number 74, the right tackle, Karen. Nate Karen, 6'8", 340. He was out leading the charge on that. And if you're a DB, that's not the guy you want to see running down at you.
No. Well, I think there were two or three guys besides Nate out there. And, I mean, that was one of those things where the number 83, who's the receiver, Ted Crane, had his hand on the back of that convoy. That was dangerous for the Scots. That was a good job just to get him down where they did. First and 10 as a result of the play. Scots have pressure on the quarterback looking downfield.
He's going to throw it away.
Yep. And again, a good, you know, we saw Petrich make that decision before the touchdown. Sometimes you just have to give up on the play.
Jared Brogni on the pressure, the line defensive lineman there, putting the pressure and chasing the quarterback down and make them just get rid of it.
So for Lake Forest, it's going to be second and 10 on the 41. Cleary, and some instructions to the group. Alex Adams will line up behind him. And that's one thing, if They're going to run Adams up the middle.
He runs into a wall.
Well, I was going to say, I have not seen Lake Forest. They were crisper, certainly, in the second half passing the ball, but they have not gone back to that middle running game that we saw that had been effective for a little bit. For a little while, Adams and Edlin had some sequence of runs that were, Scots are having trouble getting them down.
Well, here we go. Big third down here. The Scots looking to make another huge stop. Let's keep your eye on the pass rushers here. And, certainly Bartz has put a lot of pressure. We'll see what Mullenbach dials up here for his defense.
Yeah, third and nine. Let's see if they send an extra rusher or two. They only send three. Drop eight in the coverage. And
oh!
Ball just off the receiver's hands. Nice throw by Cleary. And likely that Lake Forest will need to punt.
That's a break for the Scots. That was a great throw. Just couldn't bring it in. I mean, it was wide open in space there, and he just couldn't bring it in. So big break for the Scots. Another stop for that defense. And if you're the offense, you got to be feeling pretty good. You can get the ball in decent field position, chance to milk some clock and go down and hopefully score.
Fourth and nine. Don't think we'll see Lake Forest take punt. Get it all the way back to the punter. Nice.
That's a nice kick.
Spiral punt. Fair catch called for by Smith. That was a very nice punt. That's going to flip the field very well for Lake Forest. Scott will take over deep inside of their own territory on the 18-yard line. 28-21 with 10:15 left. Josh, we're not necessarily getting to see it as much because we haven't gotten this remote monitor working, but we're taking the technology one at a time, and Matt McLagan doing a nice job of getting some additional camera angles and some replay going down at the end. And if you enjoy that, do drop a note to Matt. He's been working really hard on getting the production values up a little bit.
It makes you think of when you watch a national broadcast. At the end, they thank all the guys in the truck and the
guys
crew.
In the truck, that's right.
You're right. Matt's taking this to the next level. And certainly, for you out there who are watching, hopefully you're enjoying it and seeing the two camera angles and seeing the replay. And it's just really cool to be able to bring that to you. And Carmack Point, kudos to Matt and his crew that he has out here working cameras. Yeah, all the people back in the truck.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's a long way from this would date both of us, Josh, but it's a long way from Luke Frederick with the laptop and no video sitting on the 100-meter indoor track above a basketball game. I think that was the first broadcasty sort of thing we did, and that was when we were both still in school. You were doing the table with Andy Johnson, and I think I was sitting somewhere at the end of the bench for basketball. There's a throw outside to Strybeck, but it's come a long way, and that ability to sort of network parents in has come a long way. And obviously, we get a lot for football that come, but maybe some of the extended family that enjoy this kind of thing.
And it's important at a place like Mac to be able to have this, because we've talked about it earlier today and how spread out across the United States and even the world, where the roster comes from, to have friends and family back home be able to watch these games and see their loved ones playing every Saturday.
Coming up on 9 minutes left, and Macalester on the friendly side of the scoreboard right now, 28-21 ahead of Lake Forest. Third and three on the 25. Snap, they're going to hand off to Stefan. I have a multiple option look, and Stefan rumbles ahead. It's going to be
close. He's got a
pretty
good spot.
Yep.
That spot where the linesman's got it marked, that's a first down.
He is signaling down right now.
Well, that's a key pickup right there. Credit Stefan for really, keeping his legs moving and keep moving forward. We get another set of downs here, and with that, it's going to be more clock. It's going to be coming off.
Boy, Stefan's got this. He has a lot of trouble keeping that towel attached to him. I'm sure that's part of having a bunch of people trying to tackle you, but he's constantly having to resituate that in his waistband. Another play where he was, was 10 yards away from him. Go get it. There's Petrich out to Strybeck. He's got one person to beat. Nice tackle on the outside.
Number three, Joey Jockwind? Jockin.
Yep. Nice individual tackle on the outside. hold Strybeck up. Strybeck had some serious room to run if he got through that tackle. 8 minutes left. Got to get the ball from the sideline. That's really playing methodical pace right now. Second and 10. Snap. Rich outside to Bresson. And Bresson tackled. 36. Does go out of bounds, so the clock will stop. 7:30 left on the clock. Third down and 3 to go.
This is the same down and distance, it seems like, on the last play where Stefan picked up 4 yards.
Knee in motion. Petrich checks his wristband one more time. Play clock down to 2. There's a snap. Petrich drops back. Throws. Catch by Knee. First down to the Scots. Knee, a nice job. Get to the line. Turn catch.
It was a great job by Knee running a route that he knew, you know, exactly where the sticks were. You know, get 1 yard beyond him. Turn around, and Petrich put it right on him. In the 2 games I've seen Patriots, just this being the second, I said in the first how impressed he was, and continues to impress here, making really good throws in big situations.
Yeah, I mean, I think the key to the Scott's success is going to be those senior wide receivers and Patriots all being able to keep it this kind of a relationship and tempo. There's Patriots way downfield going for Bresson. And I think that we talked a little bit about Alec Beattie and his safety coverage. He did a nice job coming over to make the play as a safety.
He broke that. He broke that pass up. Yeah, I mean, he was going to be intercepted again. Yeah. And Beattie comes up and makes a huge play. Unfortunately, Petrich missed Strybeck, who was off here in the flat, wide open, with nobody even near him. But when you're running for when you're running away from defenders like that, and you're trying to keep their eyes downfield, you'll miss guys like that every now and then. But he certainly had Strybeck, who was going to run for a while.
That was a heck of a punt.
Yeah.
And now it's going to be 2nd and 10 after Scots take a long shot downfield. Patrick's rhythm throw outside. Nice catch by Bresson. He's only going to get 1 yard, but he pulled that ball off his shoe tops.
Here we go.
3rd and 8. I mean, the Scots have carved 3 minutes out, but they're only 1 score ahead right now. So it's not like it's not like that's a trade that they'll make for no points on the board for that much time on the clock.
Yeah. That being said, you know, if you're the coaching staff too, you've seen your defense make 2 huge stops, and you're thinking, boy, you know, the adjustments we made at halftime and the way that they're playing, you know, it's not the worst thing to move the ball, and you know, and you have to punt it deep into Lake Forest territory.
Crossing out Strybeck off of his hands. That likely was not going to get the first down anyway. So, Scots will bring on their punt unit. Ball back over to Lake Forest. 5:28 left in the 4th quarter.
Defense going to be looking for at least 1 more big stop here. They've done it twice in a row. We will see soon if they have 1 more in them.
Chosey with the punt. Fair catch called for by Lake Forest. And they're going to start their drive at the 23-yard line. Nice kick by Chosey. Wind a little bit at his back on that.
Checking the big windmill.
Big windmill. Yeah, it's not doing too much. The telltales on the goalposts are a little more active, but not much. It's I have a feeling it would be very chilly here if we had much.
It feels like the temperature has dropped here as this game's gone on.
Yeah, it's certainly brisk. It's a brisk football game. The Dinah Band and their dance team looked pretty chilly when they were out performing at halftime. There's a swing pass to the outside. Adams runs over a couple of Scots. It takes three Scots to bring him down.
And number 55, Bart, was the first one in there, and he ended up on the receiving end of a hit.
Yeah, boy, the Scots players, have quite a matchup with those two running backs. There's the head fake and go downfield, and a nice throw and catch. Boy, that was perfectly thrown.
That was a great throw. He didn't have a big window to get it into, but he found it.
The touch by the two quarterbacks, Cleary and Patrick, have been wonderful today. There's Cleary, handoff to Adams. He makes a move in the middle, and then he takes the entire, literally all but one of the Scots defenders to stand him up.
Well, we got a flag. I'd be curious to see what that's going to be on the far end of the field. Came from the official there on the sideline.
Yeah, that'll be an interesting one.
Personal foul, face mask.
Defense. Face mask on the Scots. That one, it's going
to
hurt.
15-yard penalty will be added to the end of the run. First down.
So, well, Lake Forest has flipped this pretty quickly, and now they're knocking on the door.
Yep. 4 minutes, 30 seconds left. So taking Lake Forest exactly a minute to move between the 20s. Scott's 7-point lead. Looking a little bit in danger right now. The Lake Forest driving at the 9-yard line. Cleary drops back, throws the slant. Caught. Right near the first down. Looks like they're going to have it by 2 yards, and so it's going to be first and goal at the 7-yard line.
That was a great catch. That ball was behind him. He did a good job adjusting his body in midair to reach back and snag that in.
Lake Forest moving very quickly now on offense. Cleary pressured. Outruns the Scots defender. He's going to take it himself. Run out of bounds at the 4-yard line. Mark it. Going to be easy. Second down and 4 to go. Clock still running, under 4 minutes now in the game. Got shaping up to have one more crack at the, ball.
They should get it with relatively.
And we're not guaranteeing that Lake Forest scores, but the bonus for the Scots. And Adams the touchdown. Yep. That's going to give the Scots some time to get back and score. They're ahead by one right now, and we mentioned that just because we've seen some difficulty with the teams on extra point kicks, field goals. 28-27, Scott's ahead still, and Lake Forest looking to add on the extra point. The cool game, so a lot on the long snapper, Tucker Gill, holders L.J.
Sure
Smith.
They've got the right feel, and
Michael Bounds the kick. Line up. Snap, hold looks good, and tipped by the Scots, and it's off the bottom of the upright. And as we said, that's an important part of the game and one that has not been easy today for either team.
And that was not, I don't think there was a snap issue or a transfer issue there. He just hit it low, and the Scots got I didn't see who got a hand on it, but someone got a hand on it.
Yep, team block.
Yeah,
team block. And so 28-27, and now I think Lake Forest on defense has to be incredibly aggressive. Lake Forest has all three of their timeouts, still 3 minutes and 30 seconds left in the ball game. But, Macalester.
They're going to have to get a couple of first downs.
Yeah.
I mean, they're going
to extend this game.
Having timeouts still, they're going to need to get a couple of first downs.
And the Scots seem to think that Lake Forest will try an onside kick. A little surprised with all those timeouts in your pocket. I would expect to see them try to make their defense heal in. not what they're going to do. Well, that's not what the Scots think. Hands team on, so Strybick and Knee and Beatty all in the front row for the Scott. That's a good point. Scott's furiously trying to get Stefan off the field, and they finally do. And he got off to the right spot. Scott's had 12 people on the field. Here's the kick deep. It's going to go to Bresson.
It's a late fair catch call.
Yep. That's a very interesting rule. We've seen that applied twice in two different situations. That time Bresson picked up 10 yards or so and without any real risk of fumbling or anything. Mm-hmm. And Lake Forest applied that at the end of the first half in order to keep the clock stopped and move up.
Well, you know, we said I think Max have to pick up probably at least two first downs given that Lake Forest has its full complement of timeouts and 3:35 remaining here. So,
and I would say that I'm not sitting in front of any stats in front of me right now, but almost every bit of offensive movement for the Scots has been through the air, pretty much. And so, while they'll run Stefan on this one, they're going to have to throw the ball. So the other one is they're going to have to, you know, Petrich has been wonderful today on his touch passes, but he's going to have to continue to be perfect in terms of not doing the turnovers through the air on this. I mean, I think that's the one other risk with the way the Scots offense works is that in times like this where ball control is important, you are letting it go and letting the air have the ball for a little bit.
You know, but we talk about them milking this thing here. I also wouldn't be surprised if, you know, they lull this defense to sleep a little bit and then try to hit Beatty behind.
Yeah.
Got a one-on-one matchup down here on the near side.
Yeah, points would make this very tough.
If they roll a safety over to help on that side, I certainly would if I was calling the defense.
Yep, Beatty goes out and posts. Ooh, there's a collective gasp in the stadium as Petrich had the ball out.
A little careless with the football there. He realized it quickly and brought it back in. So here we go, third and two.
Yeah, and this sets up a really interesting call. I mean, I'm sure Stefan would advocate very hard for a run up the middle for him. And I think Beatty and Knee and the rest of the gang would also go hard for some sort of an out toward the sideline.
Yeah.
Clock's down at 2:10, and it's continuing to wind. Scott's will be able to snap the ball right at about 2 minutes. Strybick in motion. Now Knee in motion. I'll fake the handoff to Knee. Stefan up the middle. He's got the first down. That's a huge pickup for the Scots.
We've seen that play before right there where they fake the jet sweep and then give it to Stefan on an inside run. Who's down here?
Down and hurt offensive line, it looks like. So just under 2 minutes left in the ball game. We're going to take an injury timeout for one of the Scots players. 28-27, Scots had the lead. Now trying to work on the clock as well as the scoreboard. Take a break with the team. So injured player getting helped off by the Scots training staff. As we said, a great group of individuals that Paul and Nat Vig and rest of the team that puts in so much time for the athletic, the certified athletic trainers and all the assistants. A lot of time and effort and attention put in to take care of these guys.
Well,
good hand for that player. So it's going to be first and 10 for the Scots after a great run by Stefan.
That's the offense. The center, Szymanski, is the one hurt leaving, and he's replaced by number 73, Jake Nation. So certainly very important to make sure these snaps are handled well and get back to Petridge with a new center in the game.
Petridge pulls right. Arm fake, and he's going to try to get his blocker engaged in front of him. Until he finally goes down after gain of 6 or 7 on the
and
play.
And that was the new guy, 73 J yeah. Nation, out there leading the way.
Right. Lake Forest will call a timeout. We'll stay here with him. And that is, you know, Josh, we were talking a little bit about the evolution of programs, and I think that's the kind of depth right there. I mean, that's a incredibly, I mean, talk about it less than we should, but it's an incredibly important position in the center, especially in this offense, shotgun all the time. And to bring somebody in and somebody that can make a play, hold, in the fourth quarter after having not played, I mean, that's a big plus. Great job by that person being able to step in with 1:20 left in the game and you're front center of everybody.
There was a time when maybe center got hurt and the next guy up, maybe he never snapped shotgun before, you know, and maybe now they've got a guy who has done it and comfortable.
Scots will come back after the timeout, so Lake Forest burns their first timeout. It's going to be 2nd and 4. And this is a big one. I mean, if the Scots get to 3rd and 4 or 3rd and less than 4, they're in very good conversion territory. Now Lake Forest is burning timeouts.
Well, Lake Forest is going to be calling timeouts after every play here. It's important for the Scots to, if they throw it, to complete the pass.
There's a handoff to Strybick, and that first tackle was missed, and that's going to be the one that hurts them. Strybick able to convert. That's a big play.
That's going
to – we saw this play run with Beatty the first time around, and Lake Forest blew the play up in the backfield. This time, Scott's able to use it to convert for the first down. Lake Forest will call the timeout, but with 1:16 left and only one timeout, I think Scott can run this out.
I'd need to see a replay, but I think it was a pass.
Well, yeah, it goes forward, right?
I think, you know – He did go forward there.
Yeah.
So if that's
stat
patter, if that's dropped, the clock's gonna stop.
Oh yeah, that's
they
a good
get to
point.
Save a timeout. So
yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, that was something that Lake Forest snuffed out, and it was seemed like it was a little bit too clever of a play call when they ran it the first time through. This time, really nice job. I mean, that expecting Macalester to try to line up and smash mouth a little bit, they pulled a slight bit of razzle dazzle. So just, simulating this out a little bit, I think Macalester is going to be able to cook off some time. They've got all their players in for the victory formation. And this is almost for Macalester.
First timeout,
Macalester's going to call a timeout. Must be able to
well, they just want to make sure that they've got all their math right and
yep.
they've got all their personnel in.
Yeah, yeah. And I was going to say, this actually is one of the tricky things is figuring out how you snap the ball now when everything's shotgun.
Yeah.
Probably spend 99% of the time doing a shotgun and not much like this. Thinking forward just a little bit, Scots are going to have some big games coming up for them. I mean, they basically have this thing in the way that and this is how their schedule has set up the last few years. They play Beloit, Lawrence, Ripon, first three games coming up in the conference that counts. Lawrence is here. That's going to be a noon start, a little bit different than normal on the 13th. But they basically play, when you look at the preseason rankings and stuff, they basically play the bottom up in the conference. So they really have to get on a roll coming out of this Lake Forest game. Beloit, Lawrence, Ripon are must wins for them in order to have the season that they want to have.
Yeah, certainly. And I think coming out of today's game, though, they're going to be playing with a ton of confidence. You know, they withstanded, you know, a lot of blows from Lake Forest, came back and gave a great performance.
Ooh, nice play in the backfield by number 54. They're able to get ball carrier Stefan down on the field. Lake Forest will call a timeout, but boy, that was dangerous. The Scots did that kind of play fake, then handoff, play fake to the fly person across the middle. And paused there to be a little bit of a delay until the second handoff, and the Lake Forest player was all the way in the backfield. So a minute and 11 left. That's going to be the last timeout for Lake Forest. Steve, if you count off, they run a play, 40 seconds, third down. So very likely they're going to have to run two plays. If they can convert that third down, it's completely cooked. Yep. Yep. Got a do or die. And you know, Lake Forest, it's this, I don't know what the football version of it is, kind of like the last batter in a t-ball game. You got to make it all the way around. Lake Forest has to just try to knock the ball out. And McAllister's going to
sit on it.
Yep, they're going to cook it. So they're going to snap it. And, yeah, they're going to be able to burn it out. Yep. So 40 and 40, and that'll be it. But just thinking about it, I mean, the McAllister's going to be building up towards games against. They're going to be at St. Norbert, and University of Chicago is going to come here on November 3rd. Those are going to be big games for the Scots. And, you know, I think for McAllister, they've really, you can't look out there and go, oh, we got some big ones coming up down the road. I mean, you've really got to narrow in. Beloit and Lawrence are going to be games that you really have to win talent-wise similar to you. Ripon's going to come in and run the triple option, give you something you don't see very much during the year. And then you got some big ones coming up. So good win for the Scots today, though.
They're going to have a lot of confidence going in because they played well today.
Yep.
Granted, not this game. Cormac, this is your last game here with us. We'll be missing
you. Yeah, I'm off for warmer and greener pastures in the south, going down to the land of ACC and SEC football. But, heading off for a job opportunity. This has been fun. It's now been 10 years for me doing the Scots game, so it's been quite a run. And, thankful for, Ron Osterman and Andy Johnson and Matt McLagan and folks like that give me a chance. You know, had folks like you and Nick McMullen to come in and do some games with me. And, wish you really well finishing up the year, Josh.
Yeah.
And really excited that the webcast has come along. It's been fun to see that come along and the chance for parents to be connected to the game.
It's
awesome.
We'll certainly miss you. We wish you obviously all the best. We'll continue to try to put on a first-class
broadcast. Well, yeah,
broadcast.
You picked up one more listener. Your Nielsen ratings went up from my old company. So
that's all we got to do.
Yeah,
is,
exactly.
We just got to prove listenership.
Yeah, exactly.
All right.
Thanks for listening. Scott's great victory today, 28-27. Tune back in next week. They should be on the Beloit webcast, 1 o'clock start. Week after that, Lawrence right here with Josh taking over the reins. Noon start on that one on the 13th. Thanks again. Scots victorious 28-27.